If I was there the night before, and I heard the knocking at my door, would I turn them down and let them in on Christmas Eve in Bethlehem? If I was watching o'er the fields when the angel of the Lord appeared, would I believe as the shepherds did on Christmas Eve in Bethlehem? Would I sing hallelujah at the top of my lungs? Would I fall on my knees? Would my soul be overcome in all the Savior's birth the moment he came to earth as a baby boy born? If I saw the star light up the sky, would I know a king was born that night? Leave it all behind to follow him. My life began in Bethlehem. So I'll sing hallelujah at the top. When the Son of God knocks on your door, will you turn him down or let him in for the day when Jesus comes again? When we'll sing hallelujah at the top of our lungs, we'll fall on our knees before the Father, Spirit, Son. His kingdom come to us. If I was there the night before, and I heard the knocking at my door, would I turn them down and let them in on Christmas Eve in Bethlehem? If I was watching o'er the field.
Well, good morning and welcome to worship on this final Sunday of the year 2020. I don't know about you, but I am grateful for that we're moving into 2021. Welcome as well to Sedge Garden United Methodist Church Online. I am Pastor Justin and so grateful that you're joining today. Go ahead right now, wherever you're at, Whoever you're watching with, would you drop that in the chat feature below on Facebook, YouTube, as you're watching with us today. And also, Merry Christmas. So grateful to get to say that officially, that we are at Christmas. Today, our service is going to look a little bit different, as our resident bishop, Paul Leland, will share the scriptures with us. And also his cabinet. So our bishop and district superintendents make up a cabinet, and that is who we as pastors help answer to. So think of that as like our bosses. In the midst of this pandemic, they had a heart to give a gift to all the churches so that we could have a little bit of a respite in the midst of the season and the pandemic that we're in. And so Bishop Leland will be preaching today. Members of his cabinet will be leading at different points in the service, as well as some other bands that you will see, a band from another church in our conference as they've put together a worship service. You're also going to get to see and hear our very own Sedge Garden Contemporary Worship Band. And we just pray that today would be yet again a chance of an encounter with the risen Savior Jesus Christ as we make our way to the manger. To worship the gift of Christ in our lives. So would you pray with me this morning as we prepare to worship? Gracious and loving God, it is with joy that we worship you this morning. And so may your joy permeate all that we do, not just on Christmas Eve, not just on Christmas Day, but may the fullness of the Christmastide season, all 12 days of Christmas, be permeated by your joy, by your love, by your peace, and by your hope. And so we have gathered to meet with you, meet with us, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Friends, let's sing together this morning. We will sing joy. Well, friends, as we come to celebrate this moment, life at Sedge Garden, I am so filled with gratitude for the ways that you continue to express your generosity. Don't forget, you can still give canned food to support our crisis control food drive with the goal of raising over 8,000 pounds of food by the end of this year, December 31st. This week, just a reminder, our office is open. If you would like to give a year-end gift to Sedge Garden, we'd love to receive that. You can drop by our office to give that through this week. We will be open through December 31st. We will be closed New Year's Day for the holiday. And you can always give online to partner with us at sedgegardenumc.org. As you give, know that you are giving to the Lord and that you are responding to God's grace at work in your life to see His love, His joy, His peace, and His hope come here even in greater ways. And that we, this is what's so beautiful, we are invited to help be dispensers of those to our community. And so help us sow seeds of that this year. We have a great gift, and you may have seen it. It was released on Christmas Day from our Garden Kids Ministry and Adult Discipleship Ministry, our adult ministry here at Sedge Garden. It is the retelling of Jesus' birth through the eyes and the stories and the imaginations of some of our young garden kids. And then the adults get the joy of acting out whatever they have said. So friends, enjoy this in just a few moments. After that, we'll sing another song, and then we will hear the scripture being read as well as the message from our Bishop Paul Leland. Friends, let's continue our hearts in worship this day.
All right, so you can start the story. Start with, how did Mary find out she was going to have a baby?
Angel named Gabriel came down from heaven. And
the angel found Mary. And then angels said that she was going to have a born baby.
I bring you good news of great joy. You are, God has chosen you to have Jesus, the promised son.
Mary was like, what?
It's okay. You will soon, his name will be Jesus.
And then she went to go tell Joseph and his carpenter shop. Mm-hmm. And she talked to him about it.
The same angel told Joseph.
Then a different angel came to Joseph and told him that Mary was going to have a child and he must marry her. And then he didn't want to, but then he chose to do it.
He was like, oh, fuck.
Mary and Joseph went to Bethlehem.
Mary and Joseph went to Bethlehem to sign papers because everybody had to go to Bethlehem and sign like forms for stuff. For like maybe let's say houses or something.
They had to ride on a donkey and
Mary and Joseph used their turbo running speed, but Mary had to do it on a wagon because she didn't want her baby to be mad when he was born.
Joseph's feet were like cut with all rocks. Mary was just tired.
They probably maybe like got off to take a break and maybe like picked flowers or something.
And they had to spend about 3 days traveling. And once they got there, Mary had a sigh of relief. They had to find somewhere to sleep.
They knocked on doors and then people answered and said there were too many people and you can't come in.
They tried to find a room that was left in it and it.
The innkeeper said no.
All the beds are full
we don't have enough room. Sorry.
So they walked away sadly.
They found a stable. One of them left them in a stable.
And said they had to stay in a stable.
Mary and Joseph went to the barn.
Those animals there while Jesus was born.
And there was even more animals than 100. There were 1,500.
Owls, donkeys, sheep, maybe chickens, probably.
Yucky.
And there was a crib.
All of a sudden, Mary had baby Jesus.
And me and Joseph had a baby Jesus.
And there in the same country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, came upon them the angel of the Lord with great news that their Savior was born.
The angels appeared in the sky with horns and drums.
And they were terrified and said, "Fear not, for I bring you good news of great joy."
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Maybe we should go there.
The shepherds went to the stable to see Jesus.
And they didn't just walk, they ran. They went to the stable and they met Jesus.
Aww.
And Jesus said, "Maybe we have a baby."
The three kings and the three camels came to see baby Jesus.
They came from a far desert and came all the way to Bethlehem.
People probably told them where to go, and like they probably knew, since they're called wise men, they're wise, so they probably knew that there was going to be a baby that born. So then they knocked maybe like on somebody's door and asked them like, "Where is Mary and Joseph, and where is the new baby going to be born?" And then they probably said, "The stable right over there."
One man said new.
They followed the big star.
One man gave the babies gifts.
And that's a wooden toy.
A rattle, a pacifier.
A baby toy?
They got diapers. Baby clothes?
They probably bring food or something. Maybe like a blanket or something like to lay on.
Lots of money. Food, money, and money.
Spices.
Gold, silver.
Gold, myrrh, and frankincense.
They all met baby Jesus and they all bowed down to him and prayed. And they thanked God.
The end.
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
From a throne of endless glory to cradle in the dirt.
Merry Christmas from beautiful Collins Grove United Methodist Church in Greensboro, and from all of us in the Northern Piedmont District. Today's scripture comes from the second chapter of Luke, verses 25 through 35. Hear now the word of God. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." Thanks be to God for these holy words, and may God today write them upon our hearts.
As we gather for worship this morning, giving thanks to God for the gift of His love and presence in Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, meaning God with us, I truly hope the celebration of Christmas has been deeply meaningful and happy for you and your family. Our entire world has been through a difficult year. The pandemic of 2020 has brought sickness, extended hospitalizations, economic hardships, and even death to too many of our friends and family. If there's a word we need to hear for this time, a word that might encourage us and give us hope, it is Emmanuel. God is with us. As we move from the days of Christmastide toward a new year, our scripture lesson on the Canticle of Simeon may provide some insight into the ways in which we might be guided by scripture when the Apostle Paul speaks about suffering, saying suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces courage, and courage produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us because the love of God has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us. I would encourage us not to move past Advent too quickly. There's a reason why we've been focused and placing our attention on waiting, preparing, and patience. The Gospel of Luke reminds us that Simeon and Anna met Jesus and his parents at the temple as they came for the rites of Mary's purification and the circumcision of Jesus. The Gospel of Luke begins the good news by sharing four songs or canticles of praise, starting with Mary's Magnificat, followed by Zechariah's Benedictus, in which he celebrates the birth of his son, John the Baptist. Angels then sing Gloria in Excelsis to announce the birth of Jesus. And finally, Simeon, a devout man, promised by the Holy Spirit that he would not die until he saw the Messiah, sings Nunc Dimittis at the dedication of the baby Jesus in the temple. Of the four canticles, the Magnificat has captured the imagination of composers from Mozart, Mendelssohn, Vivaldi, and the most famous version by Johann Sebastian Bach. Luke is telling us that Jesus did not come as a separate, spontaneous gift from God. Rather, his birth is the fulfillment of God's promises for all humanity. Jesus is linked to a people's suffering and journey out of slavery in Egypt, God's promises to a nation coming out of exile in Babylon, God's promises to those who live once again under the sword of Rome and are longing for God's deliverance. These four canticles tell the story not only of Israel, but of all humanity trying to find peace, a cure for a spirit of war, longing for healing from a God who will not leave us in our sins. This is clear in the Magnificat when Mary sings, "God's mercy is from generation to generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He's brought down the powerful from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy." Zechariah's canticle of praise included the promises of God when he said, "This is the oath God swore, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, and to be holy and righteous in God's sight all the days of our life." The song of the angels reminds us that something new has come when they sing to the shepherds, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, among all with whom God is pleased." And today's scripture lesson quotes Simeon, who prays to God saying, "Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel." This is a tremendous statement for us today when we can barely think past yesterday's news cycle. Is it possible, as we end this year, constantly hearing how divided and mistrusting we are of others, that we might hear God is faithful from generation to generation? Is it possible to hear that a saving salvation has been prepared in the sight of every people, for all nations? Recently, in conversation with Dean Greg Jones, Dean of Duke Divinity School, he shared how he was running out of adjectives to describe this time we are living in resulting from the pandemic. Dean Jones, like all of us, used phrases such as, this time is unprecedented. This time is unusual, unconventional, and uncertain. As he was sharing with Reverend Rob Webb, director of the Rural Church Division of the Duke Endowment, that he had run out of adjectives, Rob suggested that a phrase we might use to describe this time might be our time. Our time, the time for the church, a time for the witness of God's presence speaking into a fearful and hurting world, speaking into a divided denomination wrestling with division. Our time, a new beginning declaring a light to reveal God to the nations. We can best position ourselves to start this new beginning, our time, by modeling the spirit of Simeon, who reflected a godly life. He is firmly grounded in godliness. Meeting the Christ child was the fulfillment of his lifelong experience with God. Like us, Simeon's a normal person. He's not a priest or a ruler. What distinguishes Simeon is not his position, but his godliness. Here are four characteristics to guide us into our time. Simeon's described in the scripture lesson as righteous, which means that he was considered as one who was full of God-honoring actions. The word is primarily focused on one's conduct with others. So Simeon was known for his godly conduct toward others. He's called devout. He was careful about his religious observances. He was faithful in worshiping, meaning he regularly met with God. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. He took the promises of God contained in Scripture at their word, and he was looking for the coming Messiah. Finally, the Holy Spirit was upon him. He was a man deeply influenced and controlled by the Spirit of God. There was something about him which indicated the special presence of the Spirit. New birth does not always have to start with a physical birth, as Jesus reminded Nicodemus. For we can all be born again as our hearts give birth to love. Our spirits embrace hope for a new beginning, and our souls give birth to Christ within us. Blessings to you during this season of Christmastide. Happy New Year as we claim a new beginning, our time. Emmanuel. God is with us.
Send the night wind to the little lamb. Do you see what I see? Way up in the sky, little lamb. Do you see what I see? A star, dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite, with a tail as big as a kite.
Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy,
shepherd boy to the mighty king.
Oh, what a glorious day. Well, friends, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. I am so grateful to have had this opportunity to worship together. Two reminders. Next Sunday, we will kick off a new sermon series called Questions Kids Ask. It's questions from our Garden Kid ministry. We're going to talk about topics like who is God and does God have parents and where did he come from? We're going to talk about what is heaven like, what to expect there and who gets into heaven and are there animals in heaven? And we're going to talk about fun questions like why there are no dinosaurs recorded in the story of Noah's Ark. All of that. So the next couple weeks, we're going to explore those questions. Also, on Wednesday nights, starting next week, we will be able to launch into our Revelation Bible study. If you want to sign up to be a part of that, please call our church office. I'll be teaching it online through the Zoom platform. Would love to have you join. Lots more information in the church newsletter, on our website, and social media. With that being said, friends, thank you so much for joining us. Receive this blessing today as we get ready to go forward. May the gift of Christ, which is the joy, be made complete in you this Christmas season, and may it abound and abound and abound and carry you forward into 2021. Merry Christmas, friends, and Happy New Year.